احنا بالكلينيك
حلوه
الصوره. هيدي عصة النحلة عندها، اذا واحد عصة النحلة او زرقة او دبور في يعمل لوكال رياكشن، يعني عصتك هون
responsible for causing the illness known as botulism. However, in small doses, botulinum toxin type A can be used safely to reduce the appearance of facial lines and wrinkles. The toxin is purified and the formulations are marketed by different companies with names such as Onobotulinum Toxin A and Abobotulinum Toxin A. In this animation, they will all be referred to generically as botulinum toxin type A. With little downtime and almost immediate results, botulinum toxin type A can help you restore a smoother, more youthful appearance to the face. Two sets of muscles called the corrugators and procerus muscles lie beneath the skin between your eyebrows. These muscles allow you to squint and to furrow your brow when you frown. Contracting these muscles causes vertical frown lines called glabellar lines to appear. In addition to factors such as age, sun exposure, and heredity, one of the primary causes of facial lines and wrinkles is repetitive muscle contraction. Nerves release neurotransmitters, which are chemicals that send signals or impulses to other nerves, muscles, or the brain. Nerve impulses are what trigger muscles to contract or move. Under normal conditions, a neurotransmitter known as acetylcholine is released by nerve cells. The acetylcholine is encased in fluid-filled sacs that bind to the nerve cell membranes. Once bound, the acetylcholine is released and transmits a signal to the muscle, causing it to contract. When this happens in the muscles between your eyebrows, you squint and frown lines are formed. Repeated muscle contraction over many years may cause deep facial lines and wrinkles to form on the skin overlying the muscles. When botulinum toxin type A is injected into the treatment area, the toxin enters nerve cells and splits a special protein along the nerve membrane that is necessary for the sacs containing acetylcholine to bind properly. As a result, acetylcholine cannot bind the nerve membrane and is not released. Without the release of acetylcholine, facial muscles have such a greatly reduced ability to contract that any motion they do have is not noticeable. Consequently, the brow region has a smooth, less wrinkled appearance. Based on your pain sensitivity, your physician may apply a topical anesthetic prior to the procedure to keep you comfortable. However, this is often unnecessary. Before administering the injections, your physician will ask you to contract your facial muscles in the desired treatment area in order to determine precise injection sites. Using an ultra-fine needle, your physician will inject small amounts of botulinum toxin type A into the facial muscles along the treatment areas. If an anesthetic has not been administered, you may feel a slight stinging or burning sensation during the procedure. The entire procedure typically takes about 10 minutes. Your physician may advise precautions or restricting strenuous activities for a couple hours after your procedure to lessen your bruising risk, but most normal activities can be resumed immediately. You may notice some redness, minor swelling or bruising, or numbness around the injection sites. However, these and other symptoms are generally minor and should resolve within a few days following the procedure. Although rare, botulinum toxin may spread from an injection site to other areas of the body.
A chemical synapse is a special junction between two neurons that allows them to communicate without being physically connected. A synapse has several structures. The presynaptic neuron ends in a small bulb called the presynaptic terminal. The postsynaptic terminal membrane is directly adjacent, separated by a small space called the synaptic cleft. An action potential causes voltage-gated calcium ion channels to open in the presynaptic terminal. The influx of calcium ions prompts synaptic vesicles to release neurotransmitters via exocytosis. This neuron is releasing acetylcholine. the neurotransmitter quickly diffuses across the synaptic cleft. Two acetylcholine molecules bind with one ligand-gated sodium channel at the postsynaptic membrane, opening the channel. When enough sodium ion channels open, the postsynaptic cell depolarizes and the action potential continues along the neuron.
The presynaptic neuromuscular nerve ending contains membranous vesicles prepared to release its stored neurotransmitter, acetylcholine. Neuronal stimulation initiates a cascade of events that leads to the fusion of the neurotransmitter-containing vesicle with a nerve membrane. This process is facilitated by a group of proteins comprising the snare complex. The membrane fusion results in the release of acetylcholine into the synaptic cleft by a process of exocytosis. The acetylcholine diffuses and eventually binds to receptors on the muscle, leading to muscle contraction. Botox, botulinum toxin type A, consists of a heavy chain of 100 kilodalton and a light chain of 50 kilodalton, making up the 150 kilodalton core type A molecule. The toxin is protected by accessory hemagglutinin and non-toxic non-hemagglutinin proteins, yielding a uniform 900 kilodalton complex. This illustration shows a cross-section of the spine with a motor neuron extending into the muscle and a sensory neuron extending out of the muscle. After injection of Botox, it would be expected that most of the neurotoxin would remain at the injection site. The Botox core molecule dissociates from the accessory proteins and targets the nerve endings. The binding domain of the Botox core molecule is the C-terminal portion of the heavy chain with an acceptor on the nerve. The Botox core molecule enters the nerve cell by a process of receptor-mediated endocytosis. It is the heavy chain that contains the binding domain. The toxin is now contained in a membranous vesicle inside the cell. Soon after, the light chain is released into the cytoplasm of the nerve terminal, where it begins to cleave one of the snare proteins. In motor neurons, the light chain of the Botox core molecule blocks the release of acetylcholine by cleaving SNAP25, which is an essential component of the snare complex. When acetylcholine cannot be released, muscle contraction cannot occur. In sensory neurons, the light chain is believed to cleave SNAP25 by a similar mechanism, thereby blocking the release of neuropeptide neurotransmitters and inhibiting the sensitization of pain nerves. The toxin does not appear to affect the conduction of electrical signals along the nerve fiber or the synthesis or storage of acetylcholine.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so this is a tutorial on the branches of the external carotid artery. So it's a very brief tutorial just to introduce you to the branches and to help you to remember where they come off the external carotid artery. So we're looking here at an anterior view, and we've got the vessels of the head and neck shown on the skeleton. So you can see this pin here shows the common carotid, the right common carotid, and just lateral to that you've got the right internal jugular vein. So if I just rotate the model around, we can take a look at the external carotid artery. So I've just removed the veins of the head and neck, so we're just looking at the arterial system. So here we've got the common carotid artery, which is shown by this pin here. And then the common carotid splits into an external and internal branch. So you've got the external carotid and internal carotid. So this pin shows the internal carotid. And this pin here shows the external carotid. So the carotid system supplies all the structures in the head and neck. So the internal carotid artery doesn't have any branches in the neck, but the external carotid has 8 branches. So you've got anterior branches, posterior branches, terminal branches, and you've got 1 medial branch. So we'll take a look at these various branches. So as with many things in anatomy, there's a nice little mnemonic for remembering the branches of the external carotid. And the one I use is, some ancient lovers find old positions more stimulating. So it's quite an easy one to remember, quite a nice memorable mnemonic. So that the branches are the superior thyroid, the ascending pharyngeal, the lingual, the facial, the occipital, the posterior auricular, and then you've got the 2 terminal branches, the maxillary and the superficial temporal arteries. So the first artery that comes off just after the bifurcation of the common carotid is the superior thyroid artery. So it's this artery pinned here. So just rotate it around. You can see how it descends, and it actually descends onto the superior pole of the thyroid gland. So just above the superior thyroid, we've got the second branch, which is the ascending pharyngeal artery. So you can see it here. So as you can see, this branch comes medially off the external carotid artery and kind of posteriorly. So coming off anteriorly off the external carotid artery, just above the superior thyroid artery, is an artery called the lingual artery. And it's not shown on this model, so I'll just draw it on for diagrammatic purposes. So it comes off around here. So this is the lingual artery. Then the next artery coming off anteriorly from the external carotid is the facial artery. And in older texts, you might see this referred to as the external maxillary artery, but it's now referred to as the facial artery. And you can see its course here, so it's kind of windy, and then it comes round over the edge of the mandible. So it comes over the edge of the mandible and anteriorly over the masseter muscle. And where it comes over the edge of the mandible here, you can palpate it, so you can feel your pulse if you put your finger near to the angle of the mandible. You can feel the pulsation of the facial artery. So coming off just behind roughly the same level as the facial artery, from the posterior aspect of the external carotid, you've got the next artery, which is the occipital artery. So again, this one isn't shown, so I'll just draw it on for diagrammatic purposes. It's not anatomically accurate. So we've got this occipital artery here, which comes off and its branches extend to the posterior side of the scalp. So that comes off the posterior aspect of the external carotid at about the same level as the facial artery. So again, coming off the posterior surface of the external carotid artery, we've got the next branch, which is the posterior auricular artery. So you can see this artery here, which is pinned, and it runs behind the ear, so it gives rise to the name auricular. So posterior auricular means behind the ear. So the next two arteries are the terminal branches of the external carotid. So we've looked at six branches so far, and the way to remember whether they come off anteriorly or posteriorly is quite simple. So the way I do it is just thinking of the structures, so think of the names and think of whether the structures that their names relate to are anteriorly or posteriorly. So if we start off with the lowest branch, the superior thyroid, the thyroid gland is an anterior structure, so the superior thyroid artery is an anterior branch. Next up we've got the lingual artery. So the lingual refers to tongue, so the tongue is an anterior structure, so the lingual artery is an anterior branch. And then we've got the facial artery, so the face is anterior, so the facial artery is an anterior branch. And then posteriorly we've got the occipital artery, so the occipital bone is the back of your skull, so the occipital branch is a posterior branch. And then we've got the posterior auricular branch, and in the name it says posterior, and posterior auricular behind the ear, so that is a posterior part of the body, so it's a posterior branch. And then you've got the ascending pharyngeal, which is a medial branch, so it's kind of deep and medial and a little bit posterior. So those are the six anterior, posterior and the medial branches. So the two terminal branches are the maxillary artery and the superficial temporal artery. So the maxillary artery can be seen here, so this pin is stuck into the maxillary artery, and the superficial temporal artery runs up superficially on the scalp, so it runs right up here and then it branches into anterior and posterior branches. So remember I said that the facial artery is sometimes referred to as the external maxillary. The maxillary artery is referred to as the internal maxillary in older textbooks. So if I just rotate the model around posteriorly, we can see the maxillary artery running behind the neck of the mandible here. And if I rotate it around again to the lateral view, you can see it passing medially to the neck of the mandible, and then it passes into the infratemporal fossa and ultimately into the pterygopalatine fossa. So the superficial temporal artery you can see is pinned here, and this artery also runs posterior to the neck of the mandible, and then it runs anterior to the ear, and then it runs up onto the scalp where it separates into its posterior and anterior divisions. So that was just a very quick run through of the branches of the external carotid artery, and I just wanted to give you a way to remember those branches and to show you what order they came off the external carotid artery.
Small amount. You just prevent that. One more time, do like that. Relax, and you just help to prevent the reinforcement of those lines and make them smooth. Has no.
Just the final half, this side, tiny little pinpricks, just like a little bee sting. And just a minute or two after the botulinum toxin has been injected, you can see there's not much of a reaction at all.
Six, seven, eight. Okay. Pinch. 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 One more pinch.
Thank you.